Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents A Century of Wealth in America by Edward N. Wolff, narrated by Sean Runnette. Publisher's note: this audiobook is packaged with bonus material, which has been included on the first audio and MP3 CD. If you downloaded this audiobook in a digital format, please visit tantor.com and type A Century of Wealth into the search box. Follow the link on the book's page, then click on PDF Extra 1. When prompted, enter the access code UNEQUAL to access the bonus material. The truth is out there. The X-Files. Preface. This book is almost entirely empirical in orientation. There is very little theory, except perhaps in Chapter 6, which analyzes the life cycle model. The orientation is to rely heavily on data analysis to draw out conclusions regarding patterns of wealth accumulation and wealth trends. The work follows the Baconian method of inductive reasoning from empirical observation, rather than Descartes' method of using mathematical reasoning to develop an overarching theoretical framework. This book documents and analyzes trends in both wealth accumulation patterns and wealth inequality in the United States from 1900 to 2013. International comparisons are also provided where comparable data permits. The data presented in this book is the accumulation of over 40 years of research on this topic. In some respects, work on this book began in 1972, when I was hired by Nancy and Richard Ruggles as a research assistant at the National Bureau of Economic Research in New Haven. I was a PhD student at Yale at the time. The project was called the Measurement of Economic and Social Performance, MESP, and was funded by the National Science Foundation. My primary responsibility was to develop and implement a procedure for the statistical matching of microdatabases. One outgrowth of this work was the development of the so-called MESP database, which was the product of three statistical matches and two sets of imputations, and contains asset and liability information, as well as detailed demographic data, for a sample of 63,457 households. The database was developed from October 1972 through October 1977. Five articles on household wealth were based on this project. 1. The distributional effects of the 1969 to 1975 inflation on holdings of household wealth in the United States, 1979. 2. Estimates of the 1969 size distribution of household wealth in the United States from a synthetic database, 1980. 3. The accumulation of wealth over the life cycle, a microdata analysis, 1981. 4. Effect of alternative imputation techniques on estimates of household wealth in the U.S. in 1969, 1982. And 5. The distribution of household disposable wealth in the United States, 1983. Subsequent work relied more and more heavily on the Federal Reserve Board's Survey of Consumer Finances, SCF, starting with its 1983 survey. Some 50 articles were published from this source, including 1. Estimates of Household Wealth Inequality in the United States, 1962 to 83, 1987. 2. Changing Inequality of Wealth, 1992. 3. Trends in Household Wealth in the United States, 1962 to 1983, and 1983 to 1989, 1994. 4. Recent Trends in the Size Distribution of Household Wealth, 1988. 5. Wealth Accumulation by Age Cohort in the U.S., 1962 to 1992. The Role of Savings, Capital Gains, and Intergenerational Transfers, 1999. 6. Recent Trends in Wealth Ownership from 1983 to 1998, 2001. 7. Changes in Household Wealth in the 1980s and 1990s in the U.S., 2006. 8. Recent Trends in Household Wealth in the U.S., Rising Debt and the Middle Class Squeeze, 2011. 9. Household Wealth Trends in the United States, 1983 to 2010, 2014. 10. The Asset Price Meltdown and Household Wealth Over the Great Recession in the United States, 2014, and 11, The Middle Class Losing Ground, Losing Wealth, 2014. A few words should be said to differentiate this book from my 1995 bestseller, Top Heavy, reprinted in 1996 and then reprinted in an updated and expanded edition in 2002. Whereas Top Heavy was aimed at a relatively general audience and had very little in the way of technical detail, the current volume is aimed at a more scholarly audience and includes much more technical discussion of the methodological issues associated with measuring and analyzing household wealth. Another major difference is that the data series in my previous book ended in 1998, whereas the current volume extends it to 2013. Moreover, the current volume presents work that was only briefly touched upon in the previous work, including 1. The development of a long-term time series on the growth in average household wealth, 2. An analysis of the role of Social Security and pension wealth on household wealth accumulation and inequality, 3. Comparisons of estimates of household wealth from alternative wealth surveys, 4. More comprehensive international comparisons of household wealth inequality, 5. An econometric analysis of the life cycle model, 6. An extensive investigation of the role of bequests in household wealth accumulation, 7. A discussion of trends in asset poverty in the United States, 8. A decomposition analysis and a more extended time series analysis of the factors that have caused the rise in wealth inequality in the United States over the last 30 years, and 9. An investigation of wealth trends over the period that included the so-called Great Recession. 11 sets of findings in particular are highlighted in this volume. The first is the remarkable growth in household wealth over the 20th century, and in particular over the 1980s, 1990s, and early to mid-2000s. What is particularly surprising is that despite the well-publicized decline in personal savings rates since the early 1980s, the growth in household wealth continued unabated over this period. Chapter 5 helps to unravel this seeming contradiction. The second is the sharp increase in wealth inequality in the United States over the last 4 decades. The wealth share of the richest 1% of households almost doubled between the mid-1970s and 2013. During the 1980s, 1990s, and 2000s, almost the entire growth in household wealth accrued to the richest 20% of households and almost two-thirds to the richest 1% alone. There is clear evidence of a growing bifurcation in the United States between the favored fifth and almost all the rest. The third is the incredible run-up of debt by the middle class. Between 1983 and 2007, these households' debt more than doubled from 67 to 157% of their income, and the ratio of debt to net worth climbed from 37 to 61%. The bulk of this debt was secured by real estate in the form of home mortgages. This made the middle class particularly vulnerable when the financial crisis hit in 2007. The fourth is the precipitous decline in the wealth of the average family that occurred over the Great Recession from 2007 to 2013. Indeed, by 2013, median household wealth was back to where it had been in 1969. There were two key factors at play here. First, middle-class families had reached a high level of indebtedness by 2007. Second, over three-fifths of their wealth was tied up in their own homes. As a result, the steep plunge in housing prices of 24% was leveraged into an even greater decline in their wealth of 44%. There is also evidence of substantial dissavings among the middle class over these years. Differential leverage between the top 1% and the middle class also played a key role in accounting for movements in wealth inequality over time. The fifth is that tremendous shifts occurred in the wealth holdings of different demographic groups in the United States. Elderly families witnessed a steady growth in their relative wealth holdings over the post-war period. In contrast, young families and families with children saw their relative economic status decline almost continuously over the last 30 years or so. The average wealth of black families was about the same relative to white families in 2007 as in 1983, a ratio of 0.19. But by 2013, the ratio had slipped to 0.13. Moreover, in 2013, the racial wealth gap was still more than three times as great as the corresponding income gap. The sixth confronts the recent argument that with the huge growth in pension wealth, particularly defined contribution plans, stock ownership was spreading widely in U.S. society. Chapter 3 documents a significant increase in the percentage of families that had an interest in the stock market, either directly or indirectly, through various pension plans from 1962 to 2001. After 2001, however, stock ownership rates fell off. Moreover, the concentration of stock ownership in America was still as great in 2013 as it had been in 1983. The seventh concerns the role of Social Security and defined benefit pension wealth on trends in overall wealth inequality. It has long been known that including Social Security wealth along with conventional wealth in the household balance sheet will reduce measured wealth inequality. Moreover, given the tremendous growth of Social Security wealth relative to conventional wealth since the program began in 1937, the equalizing effect increased over time. However, wealth based on private pensions became more unequally distributed in recent years. Because private pension wealth was the fastest growing component of total wealth, the net equalizing effect of total retirement wealth has actually declined since 1983. The eighth is the amazing turnaround in the level of inequality of the United States relative to other countries at a similar level of economic development. By almost any conceivable index, household income, equivalent income, poverty, and household wealth, the United States is today the most unequal country, or nearly so, among the advanced industrialized nations of the world. This has not always been the case. In the early part of this century, and even in the 1950s, the United States ranked among the more equal in this group of countries. Chapter 4 will document these disturbing changes with regard to personal wealth inequality. The ninth is that the standard model of savings, the life cycle model, explains only a small fraction of the variation of wealth among households, on the order of 5 to 10%. In contrast, there is direct survey evidence that intergenerational transfers of wealth may explain upwards of 40% of the total household lifetime accumulation of wealth. If this is not the case, we are led to the rather bleak conclusion that the United States is not a land of equal opportunity for all, but rather one in which social class plays a very important role. The tenth is the remarkable persistence of asset poverty, defined as the lack of financial resources to provide for normal consumption over a period of 3 months, over years 1983 to 2007, despite a sharp increase in median household net worth. The Great Recession, perhaps not surprisingly, witnessed a substantial spike in the incidence of asset poverty. The 11th, on a positive note, is the enormous increase in household wealth over the long term. Real marketable wealth per household enjoyed a fourfold increase from 1900 to 2013, and real per capita wealth mushroomed by a factor of 7.5 over these years. Chapter 12. A note to listeners, if you prefer not to plod through all of the technical details, I recommend that you skip to chapter 15 first, which contains an apt summary of principal findings. Part 1. Recent Developments in Personal Wealth. Chapter 1. Plan of the Book and Historical Backdrop. This chapter provides an overview of trends in the standard of living, the poverty rate, income inequality, labor earnings, and the wage share of national income since 1947. With this historical backdrop in mind, the rest of the book focuses on household wealth. Part 1 looks at recent developments in personal wealth in the United States and several other advanced economies. Chapter 2 documents trends in mean and median household net worth and net worth inequality over the half-century from 1962 to 2013. Relying on calculations from the Survey of Consumer Finances, SCF, from the Federal Reserve Board in Washington, D.C., as well as several other household surveys, particular attention is devoted to developments during the event usually referred to as the Great Recession, 2007 to 2013. Before proceeding to the statistical analysis, Chapter 2 addresses three preliminary issues. Historical background on trends in asset prices and the like between 2001 and 2013 is followed by several rationales for looking at household wealth as an indicator of personal well-being. The primary data sources used for Chapter 2 are SCFs covering the years 1983 to 2013. Each survey consists of a core representative sample combined with a high-income supplement. Data were also drawn from the 1962 Survey of Financial Characteristics of Consumers, SFCC, which was conducted by the Federal Reserve Board and was a precursor to the SCF. This is also a stratified sample that oversamples high-income households. The second is the 1969 MESP, Measurement of Economic and Social Performance Database, a synthetic data set constructed from income tax returns and information provided in the 1970 U.S. Census of Population. Property income flows, such as dividends, in the tax data were then capitalized into corresponding asset values, such as stocks, to obtain estimates of household wealth. The statistical analysis in Chapter 2 documents time trends in both median and mean wealth from 1962 to 2013, with special attention paid to the Great Recession period from 2007 to 2013. In particular, the chapter reports that after robust growth in median wealth in real terms, there followed a massive destruction of household wealth, with median wealth plunging by a staggering 44% from 2007 to 2010. This analysis is followed by a look at trends in wealth inequality over the same period. The estimates show that wealth inequality in 1983 was quite close to its level in 1962. After rising steeply between 1983 and 1989, it remained virtually unchanged from 1989 to 2007. The years 2007 and 2010 saw another sharp elevation in wealth inequality. Comparisons with income inequality movements are also presented. The investigation of inequality continues with calculation of the share of total wealth gains accruing to different wealth groups. All in all, the greatest gains in wealth over these years were enjoyed by the upper 20%, particularly the top 1% of the wealth distributions. A review of time trends using alternative wealth concepts and measures and makes comparisons with another data source. The first part considers how the inclusion of the value of autos and other vehicles affects measured wealth trends. The second part presents comparisons of post-2000 trends between SCF data and data from the Panel Study of Income Dynamics, PSID. Chapter 3 analyzes changes in the portfolio composition of household wealth from 1983 to 2013, the period for which consistent data exists, and computes rates of return on household wealth over the same period. It also looks at developments in ownership rates for various asset classes, such as stocks and defined contribution, DC, plans. A notable finding is the sharp rise in relative indebtedness, with the overall ratio of debt to net worth climbing from 15% in 1983 to 18% in 2013, and the overall debt-income ratio surging from 68% in 1983 to 107% in 2013. A portfolio composition analysis by wealth class then indicates that there are marked class differences in how middle-income families and the rich save their income. In 2013, about three-fifths of middle-class wealth was invested in primary residences, and another 20% went into monetary savings of one form or another. Their debt-to-net worth was very high, 0.64, and their debt-to-income ratio was 1.25. In contrast, the top 1% invested over 80% of their savings in investment vehicles. Their debt-to-net worth ratio was 0.026, and their debt-to-income ratio was 0.38, both ratios substantially lower than for the middle class. The rather staggering debt level of the middle class in 2013 raises the question of whether this was a recent phenomenon or whether it was going on for some time. Chapter 3 documents a sharp rise in middle class indebtedness between 1983 and 2013, as well as deterioration in the financial resources available to the middle class. Ownership of investment assets is concentrated in the top 10% of families, accounting for about 85 to 90% of stocks, bonds, trusts, and business equity, and over 3/4 of non-home real estate. Detail is presented on what happened in the housing market from 2007 to 2013. Calculations of rates of return on household portfolios show that differences in portfolio composition, particularly leverage, indebtedness, between wealth classes, translates into large disparities in rates of return on household wealth. Differences in returns between the top 1% and the middle 3 quintiles were quite substantial in some years. In the 2001 to 2007 period, when asset prices were generally rising, the annual return on net worth was 5.6% for the latter and 3.9% for the former, a difference of 1.7 percentage points. In contrast, over years 2007 to 2010, when asset prices declined, the return was minus 6.5% for the top 1% and minus 10.6% for the middle group, a differential of 4.1 percentage points in favor of the top 1%. Chapter 3 then considers stock ownership. The percentage of families that had an interest in the stock market, either through direct ownership of stock shares or indirectly through pension accounts and the like, surged from 32 to 52% between 1989 and 2001, but then fell off to 46% in 2013. This analysis is followed by a look at trends in ownership rates and the value of defined contribution pension accounts. How does U.S. wealth inequality compare with that of other countries? How have relative levels of inequality changed over time? How does the U.S. level of median and mean wealth compare to those of other advanced economies? These issues provide an international context for the experiences in the United States. Chapter 4 presents international comparisons of personal wealth inequality for a number of countries and over time. There is recent historical data on personal wealth inequality available for Canada, France, Germany, Japan, Sweden, and the United Kingdom. The evidence shows that the rise in wealth inequality during the 1980s observed for the United States was not general among industrialized countries, at least among those for which the requisite data are available. In contrast, the rise in income inequality seems to be more widespread. Second, the evidence suggests that in comparison with other advanced countries with comparable data, the United States, by the 1980s, ranked as the most unequal country in terms of wealth inequality. This same was true for income inequality. The situation was basically unchanged by 2000 and 2010. Third, the relatively high U.S. wealth inequality today appears to be a marked turnaround from the early part of the 20th century, when the country appeared considerably more equal in terms of wealth ownership than European countries such as Great Britain and Sweden. It also contrasts with the early 1970s, when wealth inequality in the United States appeared to be comparable with levels in other industrialized countries. Fourth, the results also indicate that while the United States ranked highest in terms of mean wealth per adult around the year 2000 among countries for which comparable data are available, the country ranked relatively low in terms of median wealth per adult. By 2010, the United States had slipped to 3rd place among 8 countries in terms of mean wealth, but last place in terms of median net worth. Part two of the book considers some of the mechanisms behind changing wealth inequality. Chapter five deconstructs wealth trends over the period from 1922 to 2013. Two methods are used to analyze trends in wealth inequality. The first relies on decomposition analysis from 1983 to 2013. The change in wealth over a period can be decomposed into capital reevaluation, savings, and net intergenerational transfers. The same decomposition can be used for different parts of the wealth distribution, such as the top 1% and the middle three wealth quintiles. Here, capital revaluation explains about 80% or more of the change in overall simulated mean net worth over the 1983 to 1989, 1989 to 2001, 2001 to 2007, 2007 to 2010, and 2010 to 2013 periods. This finding was true for all households, the top 1% and the middle three wealth quintiles. For changes in inequality, I look at changes in the ratio of net worth between the top 1% and the middle three wealth quintiles. Trends in this P99 to P2080 ratio were influenced mainly by differentials in rates of return and saving rates between the two groups, with the former generally lowering inequality and the latter raising it. Over years 1983 to 1989, savings rate differences explained over 100% of the rise in the P99 to P2080 ratio. Over years 1989 to 2001, the higher rate of return of the middle group lowered the rise in the ratio by 45%, while the higher savings rate of the top group raised it by 137%. Over years 2001 to 2007, the higher rate of return of the middle group offset their lower savings rate. Between 2007 and 2010, both factors contributed positively to the rise in the P99 to P2080 ratio, and each explained about half. From 2010 to 2013, the higher savings rate of the top group added positively to the rise in the P99 to P2080 ratio, while the higher returns on wealth of the middle group made a negative contribution. The second method is regression analysis to analyze the factors that seem to play an important role in movements in household wealth inequality over time, over the period from 1922 to 2013. The dependent variable is the share of wealth of the top 1% of wealth holders. Three explanatory variables appear to be particularly important. The first is the income share of the top 1% of income recipients, whose estimated coefficient is positive and significant at the 1% level. The second is the ratio of stock to home prices, whose estimated coefficient is also positive and significant at the 10% level. The third is the ratio of total debt to net worth, which has a negative coefficient significant at the 1% level. Chapter 5 also confronts Piketty's law, which states that wealth inequality rises if the rate of return on capital is greater than the rate of real output growth. Evidence for the United States in the years 1983 to 2013 finds no confirmation of this law. Instead, it is argued that wealth inequality generally rises if the rate of return on wealth is greater for the top 1% than for the middle class. Another approach to understanding wealth inequality is based on the so-called life cycle model, in which it is argued that households accumulate wealth during working years in order to ensure adequate consumption during retirement years. This theory implies a rising level of wealth with age until retirement, followed by a continuous decline. Chapter 6 provides an economic analysis of the life cycle model and considers its implications for wealth accumulation. The chapter begins with a brief survey of the literature of the life cycle model. Econometric analysis is then applied to the life cycle model using traditional concepts of household wealth. The results suggest that although the coefficients of such a model are statistically significant, the model itself explains only a very small fraction of the variation in household wealth, at most on the order of 5 to 10%. When confined to the middle class, the model performs much better. The implication is that the life cycle model provides a useful explanation of wealth accumulation motives for the middle class. In particular, it suggests that this class acquires wealth for retirement, liquidity, and consumption purposes. The upper classes, however, are more likely to accumulate wealth for other reasons, perhaps power and prestige, and bequest models are more appropriate for explaining the distribution of wealth within this class. Pension and Social Security wealth can be incorporated quite directly into the life cycle model of household wealth accumulation, since they are forms of retirement wealth. The question arises as to how much their inclusion into the household wealth portfolio improves the explanatory power of the life cycle model. Cross-sectional regression analysis is then performed using alternative concepts of pension and Social Security wealth. Results tend to confirm these conclusions. The performance of the model for the total population is not substantially improved, but for the middle class it accounts for substantial improvement in the degree of variation in total household wealth accounted. Another important factor accounting for disparities in wealth among households is wealth transfers, collectively inheritances and inter vivos gifts. Chapter 7 analyzes wealth transfers in relation to the distribution of wealth from 1989 to 2013. They come into play in two ways here. First, they influence time trends in median and mean household wealth. Second, they impact the household distribution of wealth and overall wealth inequality. Chapter 7 begins with a review of some of the background literature. Direct survey evidence is available from the SCF on the receipt of inheritances and gifts, as well as the amount given in the forms of gifts and donations. The survey evidence does show that bequests and gifts play a major role in wealth accumulation, as documented in the remainder of the chapter. The results reported in Chapter 7 show that on average over the period from 1989 to 2013, about one-fifth of American households at a given point of time reported wealth transfers, and these accounted for quite a sizable figure, about a quarter of their net worth. From 1989 to 2013, wealth transfers as a proportion of current net worth fell sharply, from 29 to 24%. There was little evidence of an inheritance boom. Wealth transfers tend to be equalizing in terms of the distribution of household wealth, though a number of caveats apply to this result. The rationale is that while it is true that the value of wealth transfers climbs sharply with both household income and wealth transfers as a proportion of wealth declines almost monotonically with both income and wealth level. As a result, net worth, excluding wealth transfers, is negatively correlated with wealth transfers themselves. Since the two are negatively correlated, adding wealth transfers to net worth actually reduces overall wealth inequality. Chapter 7 also includes calculations of net wealth transfers, the difference between inheritances and gifts received and gifts and donations made to others. Net wealth transfers are important in understanding trends in median and mean wealth, and are also used in the wealth simulations in Chapters 5 and 9. Chapter 8 considers the roles of Social Security and private pensions in the household accumulation of wealth. It has now become standard to include both Social Security and private defined benefit DB pension wealth in the household balance sheet. This chapter addresses two main issues with regard to the wealth created by the retirement system. First, are the time trends in mean and median wealth that are reported in Chapter 2 altered when these two additional components are included in the definition of household wealth to create augmented wealth? Second, are time trends in wealth inequality the same for augmented wealth as for the standard wealth measure? The three decades from 1983 to 2013 saw the gradual elimination of the traditional DB pension system, which is relatively equal, and the offsetting rise of DC pension coverage, which is relatively unequal. Social Security wealth, which is the most equal component of augmented wealth, was a stable presence throughout the period from 1983 to 2013. The period from 1983 to 2007 saw robust growth in standard net worth, with the median value rising by 63% in real terms among households headed by middle-aged people, ages 47 to 64. The addition of DB pension wealth and Social Security wealth resulted in a smaller gain of 33%. From 2007 to 2013, on the other hand, median net worth plummeted by 52% for this age group, but median augmented wealth was down by only 27% because of the relative increase in Social Security wealth over these years and its concentration in the middle of the wealth distribution. It is perhaps no surprise that including Social Security wealth along with conventional wealth in the household balance sheet reduces the degree of measured wealth inequality. However, what is not well known is that determined benefit pension wealth is almost as unequally distributed as conventional household wealth. Its inclusion into the household portfolio thus has a much smaller equalizing effect. Chapter 8 also shows that the equalizing effects of defined benefit pension wealth and Social Security wealth lessened between 1983 and 2007. Net worth inequality among people aged 47 to 64 years shows an increase of 0.033 Gini points from 1983 to 2007. In contrast, the Gini coefficient for augmented wealth climbed by 0.076 points. On the other hand, from 2007 to 2013, while the Gini coefficient for net worth rose by 0.043, that for augmented wealth went up by only 0.015 points. The explanation for this was the rising share of Social Security wealth in augmented wealth over the Great Recession period. Since Social Security wealth was much more equally distributed than net worth, its relative increase acted as a moderating influence on the increase of wealth inequality over these years. Part 3 identifies the individuals who constitute the rich and poor classes in America. Chapter 9 portrays wealth differences among socioeconomic groups. It is well known that there are important differences in income among different demographic groups. This chapter documents similar differences in wealth holdings. This chapter analyzes basic trends and employs decomposition analysis to isolate the sources of differences in average wealth holdings between groups. The decomposition analysis is based on differences in capital reevaluation, savings rates, and net wealth transfers between selected groups. Another approach used in this chapter is to standardize the composition of households by their average share in the population in consecutive years to analyze trends in overall mean wealth and wealth inequality. Chapter 9 also investigates wealth differences across income classes. Perhaps paramount among socioeconomic variables is income class. The chapter finds that mean net worth increases with income level. The ratio in mean net worth between the top 1% and middle income quintile was 89 in 2013. The percentage gain in mean net worth between 1983 and 2013 also rose almost mononautically with income level, indicating a fanning out of wealth differences over this period. Another notable finding is that median net worth and financial resources fell in absolute terms for the bottom three income quintiles from 1983 to 2013. By 2013, the median figure for financial resources was close to zero for the bottom two income quintiles and only $11,000 for the middle quintile. Next, the chapter considers age patterns in household wealth. The standard life cycle model predicts that wealth will rise with age until retirement age and then decline. Cross-sectional age wealth profiles for various years verify this general pattern. It is especially striking that these profiles were not invariant over time. In particular, there was a steady shift in relative wealth holdings away from younger households and toward older Americans between 1983 and 2013. This section finds that the ratio of net worth between households under age 35 and all households fell from 0.21 in 1983 to 0.11 in 2010. In constant dollar terms, their mean net worth plunged by 46% from 2007 to 2010. The ratio of the net worth of age group 35 to 44 to overall net worth declined from 0.71 in 1983 to 0.42 in 2010. In constant dollar terms, their net worth was down by 39% from 2007 to 2010. Capital losses almost fully accounted for the downward trend in simulated mean net worth for these two age groups between 2007 and 2010. In regard to racial and ethnic difference in household wealth, Chapter 9 finds that the wealth gap between black and white households was almost exactly the same in 2007 as in 1983. The ratio of mean wealth between the two groups from 2007 to 2010 declined from 0.19 to 0.14. Blacks were much more leveraged than whites, and this discrepancy led to a large spread in rate of return over the 2007 to 2010 period, which largely accounted for the relative loss. In contrast, the ratio of mean wealth between Hispanic and white households grew from 0.16 to 0.26 between 1983 and 2007. Hispanic net worth collapsed in half from 2007 to 2010, and the ratio of mean net worth with white households declined from 0.26 to 0.15. Hispanic households, like blacks, were heavily leveraged, and as a result, there was a wide differential in returns over years 2007 to 2010, which largely accounted for the relative collapse of Hispanic wealth. Another division is by educational group. The data presented in this chapter indicate that the mean net worth of college graduates was 10 times the wealth of households with fewer than 4 years of high school, and 6 times the wealth of high school graduates in 2013. Between 1983 and 2013, the mean net worth of college graduates gained 52%, while it was down by 12% for those with fewer than 4 years of high school, and by 7% for high school graduates. In 2013, the median figures for financial resources were almost zero for high school dropouts and only $3,900 for high school graduates. Another socioeconomic dimension is household type. Chapter 9 divides the population into three basic household types: married couples, single males, and single females, and further distinguishes for married couples and single females between those with children and those without. This section reports that in 2013, married couples as a group possessed the highest mean net worth, and single females with children the lowest. The ratio of mean net worth between married couples and single mothers was almost 14 to 1. From 1983 to 2013, single mothers experienced a 22% decline in their mean net worth and a 93% decline in median net worth to only $500 in 2013. Median financial resources remained basically at zero over the whole time period for single mothers. Chapter 10 investigates the demographic and workforce characteristics of the rich. Who are the rich? Do they tend to be elderly or middle-aged? What is their racial makeup? Are they all highly educated? Do they work for others or do they own their own businesses? What occupations and industries are they found in? Have these patterns changed over time? Has there been a shift from rentier wealth to entrepreneurial wealth? How do their demographics and workforce behavior compare to the general population? The empirical analysis covers selected years between 1983 and 2013. Several questions are of particular interest. First, with the substantial increase of inequality over this period, and especially with the record high salaries recorded on Wall Street and among professional workers in general, has there been a shift in the composition of the rich away from the classic coupon clippers toward entrepreneurs? Second, along with this trend, has there been a shift toward financial and professional services as the main sources of employment of the rich? Third, with the growth in Wall Street wealth, has there been a corresponding change in the composition of the rich toward younger workers and away from middle-aged and older groups? Fourth, with the large incomes recorded in the entertainment and sports industries, do we find an increasing proportion of African Americans in the ranks of the rich? Fifth, given the rising premium to education observed since the decade of the 1980s, has there been a notable shift in the composition of the rich toward college-educated workers? Looking first at the period from 1983 to 1992, there were notable increases in the share of young families in the ranks of the very rich. Second, despite significant growth in the overall educational attainment of the population between 1983 and 1992, there was no corresponding increase in the educational attainment of the top wealth and income percentile. Third, the proportion of black households among the very rich actually fell during this period, while the proportion of Hispanics remained essentially unchanged. Fourth, there was evidence that entrepreneurial activity played a significant role in gaining entry to the ranks of the very rich. With self-employed workers as a fraction of total employment among the top wealth percentile, almost doubling between 1983 and 1992, as did the corresponding share in the top income percentile from 27 to 64%. Updated results through 2013 indicate that some of these trends continued, but others were reversed. First, the very rich became decidedly older between 1992 and 2013. Second, the very rich became better educated. Third, the rich continued to remain an almost exclusively white enclave. Fourth, the number of self-employed workers, as a share of the total number of employed in the top wealth percentile, continued to advance. Chapter 11 focuses on the other end of the wealth spectrum, and in particular, on the persistence of asset poverty. As such, the chapter looks into the wealth holding of the poor. Yes, the poor do own wealth. The chapter covers the years 1962 through 2013. The first part of the chapter reports that the wealth holdings of families below the poverty line relative to those above declined from 1962 to 2001, but recovered in 2013. The second, families below the poverty line were generally equally bad off in terms of net worth as in terms of income relative to families above the poverty line. Third, the addition of defined benefit pension wealth to the household portfolio had relatively little effect on the ratio of mean wealth between the poor and the non-poor population. Fourth, in contrast, the level of Social Security wealth in the household portfolio raised the ratio of average wealth between the two groups. In the second part of the chapter, I define asset poverty as the unavailability of financial resources to provide for normal consumption over a period of 3 months. This section documents the remarkable persistence of asset poverty over the last three decades, despite a sharp increase in median household net worth, at least until 2007, and the spike in asset poverty rates over the Great Recession. Asset poverty rates for minorities are found to be over twice the rate for whites. They also fell monotonically with both age and education, were much higher for renters than homeowners, and among family types ranged from a low of about 5% for elderly couples to 50 to 65% for female single parents, depending on the year. Results on asset poverty are discouraging in that very high rates of asset poverty for the U.S. population are revealed. In 2007, even before the onset of the Great Recession, 1/4 of American families had insufficient net worth to enable them to get by for 3 months at a poverty line level of living, and over 2/5 had insufficient liquid assets to support poverty level living for a 3 month period. Rates of asset poverty were even higher for particular subgroups, 55% for minorities, 74% for families with heads aged less than 25 years, 48% for those with less than a high school degree, 70% for renters, and 65% for non-elderly female heads with children. Part 4 looks at long-term trends in household wealth. Chapter 12 first discusses methodological issues and then investigates developments in aggregate wealth and portfolio composition. The statistical analysis begins with a broad picture of 20th century trends with regard to both aggregate household wealth and its composition. The purpose of this chapter is to provide a historical context for the developments in recent years. It documents the remarkable growth in mean family wealth, which averaged 1.26% per year in real terms from 1900 to 2013, slightly outpacing growth of disposable personal income. The fastest growth was from 1989 to 2007, averaging 2.76% per year, a rate over 1.5 percentage points greater than disposable personal income growth. There were also rather dramatic changes in the composition of household wealth over the 113 years studied. Unincorporated business equity fell considerably as a proportion of total household wealth, while deposits in financial institutions increased sharply. In addition, while the homeownership rate increased steadily over the 20th century, at least until 2004, owner-occupied housing increased only moderately as a proportion of total assets. Corporate stock had the most volatile behavior in the household portfolio, reflecting price movements in the stock market. Debt as a proportion of total assets rose from 5% in 1910 to 18% in 2013. Finally, both pension reserves and Social Security wealth increased relative to marketable assets from virtually zero in 1900 to 12 and 48% respectively in 1983, though both shares did decline after that point. Chapter 13 then examines wealth inequality trends over the long term, piecing together from various sources the historical record on overall wealth concentration in the United States from 1922 to 2013. Data points from 1922 to 1983 are based on estate tax records. In addition, more detailed estimates are provided from microdata sources for the years 1962, 1969, 1983, 1989, 1992, 1995, 1998, 2001, 2004, 2007, 2010, and 2013. This chapter shows that after a somewhat erratic downward trend in wealth concentration between 1929 and the late 1970s, as measured here by the wealth share of the top 1% of households, wealth inequality rose very sharply through 1998, fell off from 1998 to 2001, and then rose gradually through 2013. Part 5 provides an analysis of a possible wealth tax, as well as the overall conclusion to the book. Chapter 14 is a policy chapter, which examines the possibility of direct wealth taxation in the United States. Both the high level of wealth inequality in the United States and its increase in recent years provide some urgency to a consideration of potential policy remedies. Personal wealth is currently taxed at the federal level in two ways: realized capital gains as part of personal income taxes and estate taxation. Should we also think about the direct taxation of household wealth? Almost a dozen European countries have or have had such a system in place, including Germany, the Netherlands, Sweden, and Switzerland. On equity grounds, the combination of income and the stock of wealth provides a better gauge of the ability to pay taxes than income alone. Moreover, there is no evidence from other advanced economies that the imposition of a modest direct tax on household wealth has had any deleterious effect on personal savings or overall economic growth. The previous book, Top Heavy, proposed a very modest tax on wealth modeled after the Swiss wealth tax system, a $100,000 exemption with marginal tax rates running from 0.05 to 0.3%. In it, calculations for year 1989 showed that such a tax structure would yield an average tax rate on household wealth of 0.2% and would reduce the average yield on household wealth by only 6%. Even the top marginal tax rate of 0.30% would reduce the average yield by only 9%. These figures suggest that disincentive effects on personal savings would be very modest indeed. Such a tax could raise $50 billion in additional revenue and have a very small impact on the tax bills of 90% of American families. This chapter provides updated estimates for 2013. Using the same Swiss-style tax structure, adjusted for inflation, from the CPIU, I estimate that $121 billion could be raised in 2013, about 4.4% of total federal tax receipts for that year. Moreover, the average tax rate on household wealth would still be 0.2%, and the new tax would reduce the average yield on household wealth by only 6.2%. Even the top marginal tax rate of 0.3% would reduce the average yield by only 9.7%. These results suggest that disincentive effects, if any, on personal savings would be very modest. Chapter 15 ties together the major findings and themes of the preceding chapters. Three appendices are also provided at the end of the book. Appendix 1 describes the statistical adjustments and imputations made to the 1962 SFCC and the 1983, 1989, 1992, and 1995 SCF. Appendix 2 details the construction of the 1969 MESP file. Appendix 3 provides methodological details on the construction of estimates for both Social Security wealth and defined benefit pension wealth. Recent trends in income, poverty, earnings, income inequality, and the wage share. The early years of the 21st century have witnessed a struggling middle class, despite relatively robust growth in overall American economy. During the first 6 years of the George W. Bush administration, from 2001 to 2007, gross domestic product, GDP, in real dollars, expanded by 16.4%, despite a brief recession in 2001, and labor productivity, real GDP divided by full-time equivalent employees, grew at an annual pace of 2.2%. Both figures were close to their post-World War II highs for similar periods. Then the Great Recession hit. The Great Recession began December 2007 and officially ended in June 2009. Over this period, real GDP fell by 4.3%, and then, from the second quarter of 2009 to the second quarter of 2013, it gained 9.2%. After that, it grew by another 6.8% through the third quarter of 2016. The unemployment rate shot up from 4.4% in May 2007 to a peak of 10% in October 2009. But by October 2016, it was down to 4.9%. What happened to living standards since 2007? What happened to poverty? What happened to wages? What happened to inequality? What happened to the wage and profit share? Is there a connection between inequality and the profit share? These are the primary themes of the second section of this chapter. But first, I will put recent events in the context of historical data for the United States going back to the end of World War II, the so-called post-war period. Income and earnings stagnate, while poverty remains unchanged. Despite the booming economy, the most common metric used to assess living standards, real median family income, the income of the average family found in the middle of the distribution when families are ranked from lowest to highest in terms of income, deflated by the consumer price index, actually rose by a paltry 1.9% from 2001 to 2007. From 1973 to 2001, it gained 20%, so that from 1973 to 2007, its total percentage gain amounted to 22%. In contrast, between 1947 and 1973, median family income more than doubled. Then the Great Recession hit. From 2007 to 2013, real median family income fell by 7.4%, despite the recovery officially beginning in June 2009. In fact, from 2000 to 2013, it was down by 7%. Median income in 2013 was back where it was in 1997. The story is a bit different for mean family income. It likewise doubled between 1947 and 1973, but then increased by 38% from 1973 to 2001. It then rose by a mere 0.7% from 2001 to 2007, for a total gain of 39% from 1973 to 2007. This is less than the increase over the preceding quarter century, but greater than the rise in median family income. The disparity between the two series mean that while mean and median income rose at about the same pace before 1973, mean income grew at a much faster rate than median income after 1973. The discrepancy reflects rising inequality since the early 1970s. Real mean family income also fell during the Great Recession. It declined by 4.4% from 2007 to 2013, less than the median. Another troubling problem is poverty. Between 1959 and 1973, there was great success in reducing poverty in America, with the overall poverty rate declining by more than half, from 22.4% to 11.1%. After that, the poverty rate has stubbornly refused to go any lower. It has generally followed the business cycle. After 1973, it generally trended upward, climbing to 15.1% in 1993, then fell back to 11.3% in 2000, only slightly above its nadir, and then rose to 12.5% in 2007. During the Great Recession, poverty once again rose, reaching 15% in 2012, and then falling to 14.5% in 2013. Another indicator of the well-being of lower-income families is the share of total income received by the bottom quintile, 20% of families. At first, the share declined, from 5% in 1947 to 4.7% in 1961. But then it rose rather steadily over time, reaching 5.7% in 1974. It then fell off sharply, to 4.1% in 2007. Over the Great Recession, it continued to fall, reaching 3.8% in 2013. A related statistic is the mean income of the poorest 20% of families in constant dollars, which shows the absolute level of income, whereas the share of income shows the relative level of income. Their average income more than doubled between 1947 and 1974, but then gained almost nothing more by 2007. The difference in post-1974 trends between this series and the share of income of the bottom quintile, which fell sharply, is that mean income was rising in the general population after 1974. Then, from 2007 to 2013, the mean income of the bottom quintile fell by an astounding 10.8% to $16,100 in 2013 dollars. This was back at the level it was in 1984. The main reason for stagnating family incomes and recalcitrant poverty is the failure of wages to rise significantly. From 2001 to 2007, real hourly wages gained a measly 2.6%, based on the Bureau of Labor Statistics, BLS, hourly wage series. This is the series most relevant to middle-class wages. Indeed, between 1973 and 2000, real hourly wages fell by 6.8%, so that between 1973 and 2007, real wages were down by 4.4%. This contrasts with the preceding years, 1947 to 1973, when real wages grew by 75%. Indeed, in 2007, the hourly wage was $19.59 per hour, in 2013 dollars, about the same level as in 1971 in real terms. Somewhat surprisingly, real wages actually rose over the Great Recession. From 2007 to 2013, they were up by 2.1%. This time trend likely reflects the fact that workers who were laid off over these years were lower paid and less skilled. Two other measures of worker pay are shown in Figure 1.5. The results also show a marked slowdown after 1973. Average wages and salaries per full-time equivalent employee, FTEE, grew by 2.3% per year from 1947 to 1973, and then only by 0.4% per year from 1973 through 2007. Average employee compensation, including fringe benefits per FTEE, increased by 2.6% per year during the first of these two periods, and then by 0.5% per year in the second. From 2007 to 2013, the former rose at an annual rate of 0.2% and the latter at 0.3% per year. Despite falling real wages, living standards were maintained by the growing labor force participation of wives, which increased from 41% in 1970 to 57% in 1988. Married women entered the labor force more slowly, starting in 1989, and by 2007, their labor force participation rate increased to only 61%. This trend was accompanied by a slowdown in the growth of real living standards. From 2007 to 2011, the participation rate of married women actually fell to 60.2%. Income inequality rises sharply. The United States has also seen rising inequality during the early 21st century, as reflected first by the Gini Index for family income. The Gini Index is the most widely used measure of inequality and ranges from a value of 0 to 100, with a low value indicating less inequality and a high value indicating more. Between 1947 and 1968, the Gini Index generally trended downward, reaching its lowest value in 1968 at 34.8. Since then, it experienced an upward ascent, gradual at first, and then more steep in the 1980s and 1990s, reaching a value of 43.2 in 2007. What happened during the Great Recession? Inequality continued to rise, according to the CPS figures, to a Gini of 44.8 in 2013. Though property income fell over this period, the middle and lower classes were hit even harder by unemployment and a reduction in hours worked. A second index, the share of total income received by the top 5% of families, has a similar time trend. It declined gradually from 17.5% in 1947 to 14.8% in 1974, and then rose after this point, especially in the 1990s, reaching 20.1% in 2007. It then increased even further to 21.2% in 2013. Close to its highest value over the post-war period. Moreover, according to data available in the World Top Incomes Database, based on IRS tax returns, the top 10% of income recipients took in almost half, 49% of the country's total income in 2013, close to the highest level recorded since the government began collecting the relevant data a century ago, when the federal government instituted an income tax. The income share of the top 1% in 2012 returned to the same level as before the Great Recession and even the Great Depression, 18.9%, up from 18.3% in 2007, though it did fall to 17.5% in 2013. What has happened to tax rates? Trends in marginal tax rates of the federal personal income tax also affect the well-being of families, as well as inequality. The first series is the top marginal tax rate, the marginal tax rate faced by the richest tax filers. In 1944, the top marginal tax rate was 94%. After the end of World War II, the top rate was reduced to 86.5% in 1946. But during the Korean War, it was back to 92% in 1953. Even in 1960, it was still at 91%. This generally declined over time as Congress implemented tax legislation. It was first lowered to 70% in 1966, then raised to 77% in 1969 to finance the war in Vietnam, then lowered again to 70% in 1975, then to 50% in 1983, Reagan's first major tax act, and then again to 28% in 1987, through the Tax Reform Act of 1986. After that, it trended upward to 31% in 1991 under the first President Bush, and then to 39.6% in 1993 under President Clinton. But by 2007, it was back down to 35% under President George W. Bush, where it remained until 2013, when President Obama raised it back to 39.6%. The other two series show the marginal tax rates at $67,000 and $33,000, both in 1995 dollars. The time patterns are quite different for these than the first. The marginal tax rate at $67,000, about the 60th percentile, was relatively low in 1946, at 36%, and generally trended upward, reaching 49% in 1980, before declining to 28% in 1986, where it remained until 2000, before falling to 25% in 2007 and 2013. The marginal tax rate at $33,000, about the 30th percentile, was also relatively low in 1946, at 25%, but it actually increased somewhat over time, reaching 28% in 1991, where it remained through 2000, before dropping to 15% from 2001 onward. All in all, tax cuts over the post-war period have generally been more generous for the rich, particularly the super-rich. Since 1946, the top marginal tax rate has fallen by a huge 47 percentage points, or by 54%. The marginal rate at $67,000 by 11 percentage points, or by 31%, and the rate at $33,000 by 10 percentage points, or by 39%. Rising profit is the key. Where did the increased output go over the last 30 years or so? Another anomaly that arose regarding the relation between productivity and earnings helps to explain. In particular, the historical connection between labor productivity growth and real wage growth also broke down after 1973. From 1947 to 1973, average real worker compensation, a broader concept than wages, including social insurance and fringe benefits, grew almost in tandem with overall labor productivity growth. While the latter averaged 2.4% per year, the former ran at 2.6% per year. Labor productivity growth plummeted after 1973. The period from 1973 to 1979, in particular, witnessed the slowest growth in labor productivity during the post-war period, 0.5% per year, the so-called productivity slowdown, and the growth in real employee compensation per worker actually turned negative during this period. From 1979 to 2001, the U.S. economy experienced a modest revival in labor productivity growth, which averaged 1.1% per year, while the growth in real employee compensation per worker, full-time equivalent employee, recovered to only 0.5% per year. From 2001 to 2007, labor productivity growth surged upward to 2.2% per year, but the latter still rose less, at 1.6% per year. Then the Great Recession hit. From 2007 to 2010, real GDP fell by 3.2% in total, not per year. And surprisingly, employment fell even more, so that labor productivity actually advanced by 6.6%. Indeed, from 2007 to 2013, labor productivity grew by 7.7%, or at an annual rate of 1.2%, close to its historical average. In contrast, average employee compensation gained only 1.7% in total, so that the gap between productivity and employee compensation widened even further. If productivity rose faster than earnings after 1973, where did the excess go? The answer is increased profitability. The basic data are from the U.S. Bureau of Economic Analysis, BEA, National Income and Product Accounts. For the definition of net products, I use the BEA's definition of total net property type income, including corporate profits, interests, rent, and half of proprietor's income. The definition excludes the Capital Consumption Allowance, or CCA. The net rate of profit is defined as the ratio of total net property income to total private net fixed capital. The net profit rate declined by 7.5 percentage points between 1947 and its nadir of 13.1% in 1982. Then it climbed by 6 percentage points from 1982 to 1997, but fell off by 1.7 percentage points between 1997 and 2001. It surged upward after 2001, reaching 20.7% in 2007. Then, over the Great Recession, the profit rate surged even more, attaining a figure of 22.5% in 2013, close to its post-war peak. Figure 1.10 also shows trends in the net profit share in national income, which is defined as the ratio of total net property income to net individual income. The net profit share fell by 4.8 percentage points between 1947 and its low point of 24.8% in 1970. It then generally drifted upward, rising by 1.9 percentage points between 1970 and 2001. During the George W. Bush years, from 2001 to 2007, the profit share jumped up by another 4.9 percentage points to reach 31.6% in 2007. Finally, over the Great Recession, the profit share jumped by another 1.5 percentage points to attain 33.8%, its highest point over the post-war period. The results clearly show that the stagnation of labor earning in the United States since the early 1970s translated into rising profits in the economy. Trends are very similar for corporate profits. The corporate profit rate, the ratio of corporate profits to the capital stock owned by the corporate sector, declined from 10.9% in 1947 to 6.5% in 1982, its low point, and then bounced back to 11.1% in 2007. Refer to Figure 1.11 in the bonus PDF. After falling sharply to 8.9% in 2008, it then rebounded to 13.3% in 2013, though still below its peak of 16.1% in 1965. Corporate profits, as a share of national income, fell from 11.1% in 1947 to 9.2% in 1970, and then rose to 12.4% in 2007. Refer to Figure 1.12 in the bonus PDF. After nosediving to 10.3% in 2008, it jumped back to 14.5% in 2013, its high for the post-war period. What is the connection between inequality and profitability? The relationship can be analyzed in two ways. First, one can compute simple correlation coefficients between the two. As measures of inequality, one can use 1, the Gini coefficient for family income, 2, the share of the top 5% as derived from the CPS data, and the shares of 3, the top 1%, 4, the top 0.1%, and 5, the top 0.01% from the World Top Incomes database. I also include the U.S. poverty rate. As measures of profitability, one can use 1, the overall profit share, 2, the overall profit rate, 3, the corporate profit rate, and 4, the corporate profit share. Income inequality generally climbed upward from the early 1980s to 2013, as did profitability, though both declined during the late 1990s. Refer to Figure 1.13 in the bonus PDF. Moreover, both, after dipping between 2007 and 2008, generally soared to new heights by 2013. The simple correlation coefficient between the Gini index for family income and the net profit rate over the 1947 to 2013 period is 0.24, significant at the 10% level. And between the Gini index and the net profit share, it is 0.36, significant at the 1% level. Refer to Table 1.1 in the bonus PDF. These relationships do not necessarily indicate causation, since the two variables are not defined independently, though a rise in the profit share could, ceteris paribus, lead to an increase in the Gini coefficient for income. This is also true for the other correlations discussed in this section. The correlation of the Gini index with the corporate profit rate, however, is negative and significant at the 5% level, and that with the corporate profit share is effectively zero. Correlations with the income share of the top 5% are higher, 0.44 and 0.4 with the net profit rate and net profit share, respectively. Both correlations are significant at the 1% level. Its correlations with the corporate profit rate and share, on the other hand, are very low or negative, and not significantly different than zero. Similar patterns exist between these three measures of profitability and the share of the top 1%, the share of the top 0.1%, and that of the top 0.01%. The poverty rate is positively correlated with the four profitability measures, and these correlation coefficients are all statistically significant. As shown in Figure 1.13, which juxtaposes the net profit share and the income share of the top 5%, both indexed at 100 in 1947, the time trends track very closely after 1993. The two were reasonably close from 1947 to 1956, and again from about 1963 to 1970. The periods when the two differed were from 1957 to 1962, and then again from 1971 to 1992. There also appears to be a break point in the two series around 1980, when they start to trend upward. Results are roughly similar between the net profit share and the income share of the top 5%. As a result, Table 1.1 in the bonus PDF also shows correlation coefficients for the 1979 to 2013 period. The correlation coefficient attains its maximum value in 1979. The correlation coefficients between the four profitability measures and the inequality measures are all now stronger in the 1979 to 2013 period than in the 1947 to 2013 period, and are all significant at the 1% level. The correlations reach as high as 0.94. On the other hand, correlations between profitability and the poverty rate are all small, negative in one case, and not statistically significant. Several interesting patterns emerge. First, the inequality measures are more strongly correlated with the overall profit rate than the overall profit share. Likewise, they have a higher correlation with the corporate profit rate than the corporate profit share. These findings make sense, since CEO compensation and compensation of other top executives are generally tied to the profit rate of a company, that is, its return on equity, not to its profit share. Moreover, stock market movements are more strongly related to trends in the profit rate than in the profit share. As a result, the compensation of all professions that are tied to the stock market should be affected by changes in the profit rate more than by changes in the profit share. Second, the corporate profit rate generally has a weaker correlation with the inequality measures than the overall net profit rate and the corporate profit share, and a smaller correlation with the inequality indices than the overall net profit share. These results probably reflect the fact that the corporate sector represents only a relatively small part of the overall economy. Third, the correlations of the top income shares, the income shares of the top 1, 0.1, and 0.01%, with profitability measures, are stronger than those involving either the overall Gini coefficient or the share of the top 5% and profitability. This pattern is also reasonable because the compensation of the very top income earners is more closely tied to the stock market, and hence movements in profitability, than the lower portions of the earnings distribution. The second method of relating inequality to profitability is an autoregressive AR1 regression of the inequality measure on each of the four measures of profitability. Results, shown in Table 1.2, found in the bonus PDF, paint a different picture than simple correlation coefficients. Over the full 1947 to 2013 period, the coefficient of the net profit rate is positive and statistically significant at the 5% level, only for the income shares of the top 1%, the top 0.1%, and the top 0.01%. The coefficient of the net profit rate is not significant for the Gini coefficient, the share of the top 5%, and the poverty rate. The coefficient of the net profit share is positive and significant only for the share of the top 1% at the 5% level and the share of the top 0.1% at the 10% level. On the other hand, there are no significant coefficients for the corporate profit rate or the corporate share. Table 1.3 in the bonus PDF shows similar results covering the period from 1979 to 2013. The coefficient of the net profit rate is positive and statistically significant at the 5 or 1% level only for the income shares of the top 1%, the top 0.1%, and the top 0.01%. The coefficient estimates are 2 to 3 times greater than the corresponding estimates for the full 1947 to 2013 period, and the T ratios are also higher. The coefficient of the net profit share is significant only for the share of the top 1% at the 10% level. Coefficients of the corporate profit rate and the corporate profit share are not significant in any case. Concluding comments. The last 40 years or so have seen slow-growing earnings and income for the middle class, as well as a stagnating poverty rate and rising inequality. In contrast, the early post-war period witnessed rapid gains in wages and family income for the middle class, in addition to a sharp decline in poverty and a moderate fall in inequality. The booming 1990s and early 2000s did not bring much relief to the middle class, with median family income growing by only 3% in total between 1989 and 2013. Personal tax rates generally fell over time, but by much more for the rich than the middle class. In sum, the middle class has been squeezed in terms of earnings and income since the early 1970s. The stagnation of living standards among the middle class over these years is attributable to the slow growth in labor earnings. While the average level of earnings, employee compensation per FTEE, almost doubled between 1947 and 1973, it advanced by only 22% from 1973 to 2013. There was no growth in real hourly wages, according to the BLS data. Though the Great Recession technically ended in June 2009, the doldrums continued in terms of personal income, particularly for the middle class. Median household income in 2013 was still well below its peak in 2007, 7.4% below. In fact, in 2013, its level was back where it was in 1997. It was not until calendar year 2015 that median household income showed any significant growth, 5.2% in real terms from 2014 to 2015, according to the U.S. Census Bureau. The main reason for the stagnation of labor earnings derives from a clear shift in national income away from labor and toward capital, particularly since the late 1970s. Many studies have documented rising income inequality in the United States and a rising profit share. This chapter shows that there was a clear connection between the two trends. Over this period, both overall and corporate profitability rose substantially, almost back to post-war highs. The stock market was in part fueled by rising profitability. While the capitalist class gained from rising profits, workers experienced almost no progress in terms of wages. On the surface, at least, there appears to be a trade-off between the advances in income made by the rich and the stagnation of income among the working class. Strong correlations are evident between inequality and profitability, particularly since 1979. Regression analysis shows that only the top income shares, those of the top 1%, the top 0.1%, and the top 0.01%, are positively and significantly related to profitability. Overall family income inequality, as measured by the Gini coefficient, the income share of the top 5%, and the poverty rate are not. Moreover, the net profit rate has a stronger and statistically more significant relationship with the top income shares than does the net profit share or corporate profit rate or share. The rationales for these results are, first, that CEO compensation and the compensation of other top executives are generally tied to a company's profit rate. that is, its return on equity, rather than to its profit share. Moreover, the stock market is likely to be related to trends in the profit rate, rather than the profit share. As a result, the compensation of all professions that are tied to the stock market is likely to be more connected to changes in the profit rate than changes in the profit share. Second, the corporate sector represents only a relatively small part of the overall economy, and so is not significantly related to overall inequality trends. Third, the correlations of the top income shares with profitability are stronger than those between either the overall Gini coefficient or the share of the top 5% with profitability, because the compensation of the very top income earners is more closely tied to the stock market, and hence movements in profitability, than the lower portions of the earnings distribution. The top income shares also have a stronger connection with the net profit rate over the 1979 to 2013 period than over the whole 1947 to 2013 period. Both the coefficient estimates and the T ratios are larger for the former than for the latter. After 1978, the trend in both inequality and profitability was generally upward, whereas before the trend was generally downward. The sharp break in both the inequality series and profitability can be traced in part to the ending of the social contract between labor and owners of capital that prevailed from the end of World War II to about 1973, the so-called Treaty of Detroit. During the golden age of American capitalism, from 1947 to 1973 or so, unions were strong. There was an implicit social contract between capital, and labor and productivity gains were about equally shared between the two. As a result, real wages increased substantially. The mid and late 1970s saw a profit squeeze. These years also saw the birth of neoliberalism and a switch in corporate philosophy from stakeholder value, whereby the interests of shareholders, workers, and clients were balanced, to shareholder value, so that maximizing stock prices became the aim of the firm. This period saw the beginning of wage stagnation and the middle class squeeze. Since 1980 or so, wages have generally risen with inflation, but not in real terms. There are two variants of this argument. According to the first variant, owners of capital became less generous toward or less solicitous of labor. Whereas previously, at least large corporations entered into a kind of social contract with their workers, one that involved rent sharing and considerable job security, capital unilaterally broke that contract and demanded more of the rents for itself. Labor thus faced a choice between lower wages and fewer jobs, with the latter being used as a threat to achieve the former. The second and related variant of the hypothesis envisions a change in the nature of shareholding away from more patient, relationship-oriented stockholders, such as insiders, and toward more impatient, return-oriented stockholders, such as fund managers, who must show quarterly results. This second variant can possibly explain the first. More activist shareholders may have demanded that management focus on creating shareholder value to the detriment of labor and other stakeholders. Lazonik has provided background on the change in norms. His work documents the shift in the basic U.S. corporate business model from about 1980 to the present, from an emphasis on stakeholder value to one on shareholder value. Lazonik called this the New Economy Business Model, NEBM, and noted its radical alteration of the terms on which workers were employed in the United States. The rise of the NEBM was also connected to the widespread adoption and diffusion of information and communications technology. Compared to the NEBM, the old economy business model, OEBM, that dominated the U.S. corporate economy from the end of World War II and into the 1980s, offered employment that was much more stable and earnings that were much more equitable. In the OEBM, employees, mainly men, typically secured well-paying jobs right after college in established companies and then worked their way up and around the corporate hierarchy over the next 3 or 4 decades of employment. In the NEBM, an employee has no expectation of a lifetime career with any particular enterprise. The NEBM set the stage for the rise in profitability that gained force around 1980. Companies no longer valued worker loyalty. Workers were expendable, if that increased the bottom line of the income statement. Another major reason for these shifting norms is that unions have shriveled in the United States, particularly in the private sector. During the 1950s and 1960s, unions were strong, and the unionization rate was high. It peaked at 33% of the labor force in 1953. By 2012, the overall unionization rate was down to 11.3%, and that in the private sector down to 6.6%. David Gordon documented the decline in the unionization rate as one of the leading causes of stagnating wages for American workers. Cross-national evidence compiled elsewhere also suggests that one of the principal reasons for stagnating U.S. wages, particularly in comparison to other advanced economies, is the low level of unionization in this country and its continuing decline. The federal government also played a role in this transformation. It once acted as a referee between labor and capital, but in the early 1980s it came to favor capital over labor. In particular, the Department of Treasury, which historically represented the interests of Wall Street, became the dominant player in the executive branch. The other major culprit was the Federal Reserve Board, which often raised interest rates, particularly during the 1980s, and used moral suasion to clamp down on the economy once wages began to rise. The remainder of this book focuses on trends in household wealth and wealth inequality. However, this historical backdrop on trends in income, poverty, earnings, income inequality, and the wage share is useful to place the subsequent findings on wealth trends in a broader context. Chapter 2. Trends in Household Wealth, 1962 to 2013. Relying on calculations from the Survey of Consumer Finances, SCF, from the Federal Reserve Board of Washington, as well as several other household surveys, this chapter documents trends in mean and median household net worth and net worth inequality over the half century from 1962 to 2013. Particular attention is devoted to how the middle class fared in terms of wealth developments from 2007 to 2010, during one of the sharpest declines in stock and real estate prices, and from 2010 to 2013 as asset prices recovered. The debt of the middle class exploded from 1983 to 2007, creating a very fragile middle class in the United States. The main question is whether their position deteriorated even more over the Great Recession. Also important to investigate is what happened to the inequality of household wealth over these years, particularly from 2007 to 2013. In particular, results will be provided for 1962, 1969, 1983, 1989, 1992, 1995, 1998, 2001, 2004, 2007, 2009, 2010, and 2013. The choice of years is dictated by the availability of survey data on household wealth. By 2013, it is possible to see what the fallout was from the financial crisis and associated recession, and which groups experienced the greatest impact. Trends in household wealth have a direct bearing on household well-being, and should therefore be of general public interest. Indeed, since the election of Barack Obama in 2012, and during the presidential campaign of 2016, the fortunes of the middle class have generated a large amount of political interest and media attention. Asset prices plunged between 2007 and 2010, but then rebounded from 2010 to 2013. The most telling finding in this chapter is that median wealth plummeted by 44% over the years 2007 to 2010, almost double the drop in housing prices, and by 2010 was at its lowest level since 1969. The inequality of net worth, as measured by the Gini coefficient, after almost two decades of little movement, increased sharply from 2007 to 2010. Rather remarkably, there was virtually no change in median and mean wealth from 2010 to 2013, according to the SCF data, despite the rebound in asset prices, which presents a new puzzle. The next section of this chapter provides some historical background, and the following one presents several rationales for looking at household wealth. Next is a discussion of the measurement of household wealth and a description of the data sources used for this study. Two sections describe time trends on median and average wealth holdings and the inequality of household wealth. For a different perspective on wealth changes, the shares of total wealth growth accruing to different wealth groups are computed using a standard wealth measure, which excludes autos and other vehicles. Finally, a study of how wealth trends differ when the value of vehicles is included in net worth compares findings on wealth trends with those derived from the Panel Study of Income Dynamics, PSID. A summary of results and concluding remarks completes the chapter. Historical background. The last two decades have witnessed some remarkable events. Perhaps most notable was the housing value cycle, featuring an explosion in home prices and then a collapse, affecting net worth and helping to precipitate the Great Recession, followed by a modest recovery. The median house price remained virtually the same in 2001 as in 1989 in real terms. The homeownership rate shot up from 62.8 to 67.7%, and the year 2001 saw a recession, albeit a short one. Despite this, house prices suddenly took off. The median sales price of existing single-family homes jumped by 17% nationwide. From 2004 to 2007, however, housing prices slowed, with the median price advancing only 1.7%. Over the years 2001 to 2007, housing prices gained 19%. The homeownership rate continued to expand, though at a somewhat slower rate, from 67.7 to 68.6%. In December 2007, the recession and associated financial crisis hit. The recession officially ended in June 2009. By then, real gross domestic product, GDP, fell by 4.3%. Subsequently, from the second quarter of 2009 to the second quarter of 2013, it gained 9.2%. After that, it grew by another 6.8% through the third quarter of 2016. The unemployment rate shot up from 4.4% in May of 2007 to a peak of 10% in October 2009, but by October 2016, it was down to 4.9%. One consequence was that asset prices plummeted. From 2007 to 2010, the median home price nosedived by 24%, and the share of households owning their own homes fell off from 68.6 to 67.2%. This was followed by a partial recovery, with median house prices rising 7.8% through September 2013, still, however, way below their 2007 value. The homeownership rate continued to contract, eventually falling to 65.1%. The housing price bubble in the years leading up to 2007 was fueled in large part by a generous expansion of credit available for home purchases and refinancing. This took a number of forms. First, many homeowners refinanced their primary mortgages. This, combined with the rise in housing prices, meant that their outstanding mortgage principal increased, thereby extracting equity from their homes. Second, many homeowners took out second mortgages and home equity loans and increased the outstanding balances on these instruments. Third, among new homeowners, credit requirements were softened and so-called no-doc loans were issued, requiring little in the way of income documentation. Many of these loans, in turn, were so-called subprime mortgages, characterized by excessively high interest rates and balloon payments made at the expiration of the loans, that is, amounts due when the terms of the loans were up. All told, average mortgage debt per household expanded by 59% in real terms between 2001 and 2007, and outstanding mortgage loans as a share of house value rose from 0.334 to 0.349, despite the 19% gain in real housing prices. In contrast to the housing market, the stock market boomed during the 1990s. Looking at the Standard & Poor's S&P 500 index, stock prices surged 159% between 1989 and 2001. Stock ownership spread, and by 2001, over half of U.S. households owned stock, either directly or indirectly. The stock market peaked in 2000 and was down by 11% by 2004. From 2004 to 2007, the stock market rebounded, with the S&P 500 rising 19%. From 2001 to 2007, stock prices were up 6%, and the stock ownership rate fell to 49%. Then came the Great Recession. Stock prices crashed from 2007 to 2009, and then partially recovered in 2010 for a net decline of 26%. The stock ownership rate also once again declined to 47%. The stock market continued to rise after 2010, and by 2013 was up 39% over 2010 and above its previous high in 2007. The stock ownership rate continued to drop to 46%. Real wages, after stagnating for many years, finally grew in the late 1990s. According to U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics, BLS, figures, real mean hourly earnings rose by 8.3% between 1995 and 2001. From 1989 to 2001, real wages rose by 4.9% in total, and median household income in constant dollars grew by 6%. Refer to Table 2.1 in the bonus PDF. Employment also surged over these years, growing by 16.7%. The civilian unemployment rate remained relatively low over these years, at 5.3% in 1989, at 4.7% in 2001, at a low point of 4% in 2000, and averaging 5.5% over these years. Real wages then rose very slowly from 2001 to 2004, with the BLS mean hourly earnings up by only 1.5% and median household income dropped by 1.6%. From 2004 to 2007, real wages rose by only 1%. Median income showed some growth over this period, rising by 3.2%. From 2001 to 2007, it gained 1.6%. Employment also grew more slowly over these years, gaining 6.7%. The unemployment rate remained low again at 4.7% in 2001 and 4.6% in 2007, with an average value of 5.2% over the period. Real wages picked up from 2007 to 2010, increasing by 3.6%. On the other hand, median household income declined by 6.7%. Refer to Table 2.1 in the bonus PDF. Moreover, employment contracted over these years by 4.8%, and the unemployment rate surged from 4.6% in 2007 to 10.5% in 2010. From 2010 to 2013, unemployment grew by 4.7%, and the unemployment rate came down to 7.4% in 2013. There was also an explosion of consumer debt leading up to the Great Recession. Between 1989 and 2001, total consumer credit outstanding in constant dollars surged by 70%, and then from 2001 to 2007, it rose by another 17%. A number of factors contributed to this. First, credit cards became generally more available. Second, credit standards were relaxed considerably, making more households eligible for credit cards. Third, credit limits were generously increased by banks hoping to make profits out of increased fees from late payments and from higher interest rates. Another source of new household indebtedness took the form of a huge increase in student loans. This issue has recently received wide attention in the press. According to the SCF data, the share of households reporting an educational loan rose from 13.4% in 2004 to 15.2% in 2007, and then surged to 19.9% in 2013. The mean value of educational loans in 2013 dollars exclusively among loan holders increased by 17% between 2004 and 2007, another 14% between 2007 and 2010, and then an additional 5% to $29,110 in 2013. The median value of educational loans went up by 19% from 2004 to 2007, another 3% between 2007 and 2010, and then an added 22% to $17,000 in 2013. These loans were heavily concentrated among younger households and, as we shall see in Chapter 9, constituted one of the factors, though not the principal one, that led to a precipitous decline in their net worth between 2007 and 2010. Another major change in the 1990s and the decade of the 2000s affecting household wealth was a major overhaul of the private pension system in the United States. As documented in Chapter 8, in 1989, 46% of all households reported holding a defined benefit, DB pension plan. DB plans are traditional pensions, such as provided by many large corporations, the federal government, and state and local governments, which guarantee a steady flow of income upon retirement. By 2007, that figure was down to 34%. The decline was pronounced among younger households, led by people under the age of 46, from 38 to 23%. As well as among middle-aged households, ages 47 to 64, from 57 to 39%. Many of these plans were replaced by defined contribution, DC, pension accounts, most notably 401k plans and individual retirement accounts, IRAs. These plans allow households to accumulate savings for retirement purposes directly. The share of all households with DC plans skyrocketed from 24% in 1989 to 53% in 2007. Among younger households, the share rose from 31 to 50%, and among middle-aged households from 28 to 64%. This transformation was even more notable in terms of actual dollar values. While the average value of DB pension wealth among all households crept up by 8%, from $63,500 in 1989 to $68,800 in 2007, the average value of DC plans shot up more than sevenfold, from $11,900 to $86,300. All figures are in 2013 dollars. Among younger households, average DB wealth actually fell in absolute terms, while DC wealth rose by a factor of 3.3. Among middle-aged households, the mean value of DB pensions also declined, while the average value of DC plans mushroomed by a factor of 6.5. These changes are important for understanding trends in household wealth, because DB pension wealth is not included in the standard measure of marketable household wealth, whereas DC wealth is included. Thus, the substitution of DC wealth for DB wealth is likely to lead to an overstatement in the true gains in household wealth, since the displacement in DB wealth is not captured. The other big story was household debt, particularly that of the middle class, which skyrocketed during these years. Over the recession, the relative indebtedness of American families continued to rise from 2007 to 2010, though it did fall off from 2010 to 2013. What have all these major transformations wrought in terms of the distribution of household wealth, particularly over the Great Recession? What impacts have these changes had on different demographic groups, particularly as defined by race, ethnicity, and age? This is the subject of the remainder of this chapter, and also of chapters 3 and 9. Why look at household wealth? Most studies have looked at the distribution of well-being or its change over time in terms of income. Family wealth, however, is also an indicator of well-being, independent of the direct financial income it provides. There are 8 reasons. First, owner-occupied housing provides services directly to its owner. Second, wealth is a source of consumption, independent of the direct money income it provides, because assets can be converted directly into cash and thus provide for immediate consumption needs. Third, the availability of financial assets can provide liquidity to a family in times of economic stress, such as occasioned by unemployment, sickness, or family breakup. Fourth, wealth accumulation is a major source of retirement security. The so-called third pillar, along with pensions and Social Security. Fifth, Wealth is an important component in measuring poverty as recommended by the National Academy of Sciences. Sixth, wealth is found to affect household behavior over and above income. Seventh, wealth-generated income does not require the same trade-offs with leisure as earned income. Eighth, in a representative democracy, as in most forms of government, the distribution of power is often related to the distribution of wealth. As a result, it is important to consider developments in personal wealth, along with both income and poverty, when evaluating changes in well-being over time. On the basis of previous research, the three indicators do not always track together, so that wealth may give a different picture of developments in well-being. In this chapter, comparisons will be drawn between wealth and income trends. Data sources and methods. The primary data sources used for this study are the 1983, 1989, 1992, 1995, 1998, 2001, 2004, 2007, 2010, and 2013 SCFs. Each survey consists of a core representative sample combined with a high-income supplement. In 1983, for example, the supplement was drawn from the Internal Revenue Service's Statistics of Income Data file. An income cutoff of $100,000 of adjusted gross income was used as the criterion for inclusion in the supplemental sample. Individuals were randomly selected for the sample within pre-designated income strata. In later years, the first sample was selected from a standard multi-stage area probability design. This part of the sample was intended to provide good coverage of asset characteristics, such as homeownership, that are broadly distributed. The second sample, the high-income supplement, was selected as a so-called list sample from statistical records, the individual tax file, derived from tax data by the Statistics of Income, SOI division of the Internal Revenue Service, IRS. In this case, the IRS provided the names and addresses of a sample of very high-income families. This second sample was designed to disproportionately select families that were likely to be relatively wealthy. The advantage of the high-income supplement is that it provides a much richer sample of high-income and therefore potentially very wealthy families. The presence of a high-income supplement creates some complications, however, because weights must be constructed to meld the high-income supplement with the core sample. Typically, about two-thirds of the cases came from the representative sample and one-third from the high-income supplement. In the 2007 SCF, the standard multi-stage area probability sample contributed 2,915 cases, and the high-income supplement contributed another 1,507 cases. The principal wealth concept used here is marketable wealth, or net worth, which is defined as the current value of all marketable or fungible assets, less the current value of debts. Net worth is thus the difference in value between total assets and total liabilities. Total assets are defined as the sum of 1. The gross value of owner-occupied housing, 2. The other real estate owned, 3. Cash and demand deposits, 4. Time and savings deposits, certificates of deposit and money market accounts, 5. Government bonds, corporate bonds, foreign bonds, and other financial securities, 6. The cash surrender value of life insurance plans, 7. The value of DC pension plans, including IRA, KEO, and 401k plans, 8. Corporate stock and mutual fund shares, 9. Net equity in unincorporated businesses, and 10. Equity in trust funds. Total liabilities are the sum of 1. Mortgage debt, 2. Consumer debt, including auto loans, and 3. Other debt, such as educational loans. This measure reflects wealth as a store of value and therefore a source of potential consumption. This is the concept that best reflects the level of well-being associated with a family's holdings. Thus, only assets that can be readily converted to cash, that is, fungible ones, are included. Though the SCF includes information on the value of vehicles owned by the household, I exclude this from my standard definition of household wealth, since the vehicle's resale value typically far understates the value of their consumption services to the household. The value of other consumer durables, such as televisions, furniture, household appliances, and the like, are not included in the SCF. Another justification for their exclusion is that this treatment is consistent with the national accounts, where purchase of vehicles and other consumer durables is counted as expenditures, not savings. Also excluded here is the value of future Social Security benefits the family may receive upon retirement, usually referred to as Social Security wealth, as well as the value of retirement benefits from defined benefit pension plans, DB pension wealth. Even though these funds are a source of future income to families, they are not in their direct control and cannot be marketed. I also use a more restricted concept of wealth, which I call financial resources, or FR. This is defined as net worth minus net equity in owner-occupied housing, the primary residence only. FR is a more liquid concept than marketable wealth, since one's home is difficult to convert into cash in the short term. Moreover, primary homes also serve a consumption purpose besides acting as a store of value. FR represents what a household can draw down without lowering its standard of living, and thus excludes homes and vehicles. Two other data sources are used in this chapter. The first of these is the 1962 Survey of Financial Characteristics of Consumers, SFCC. This survey was also conducted by the Federal Reserve Board of Washington and was a precursor to the SCF. This was also a stratified sample that oversampled high-income households. Though the sample design and questionnaire are different from the SCF, the methodology is sufficiently similar to allow comparisons with the SCF data. The second is the 1969 Measurement of Economic and Social Performance, MESP, database, a synthetic dataset constructed from income tax returns and information provided in the 1970 Census of Population. A statistical matching technique was employed to assign income tax returns for 1969 to households in the 1970 Census. Property income flows, such as dividends, and the tax data were then capitalized into corresponding asset values, such as stocks, to obtain estimates of household wealth. Estimates of the size distribution of household wealth are sensitive to the sampling frame used in survey data. The reason is that because of the extreme skewness of the distribution of household wealth, the inclusion of a high-income supplement in the sample provides much more reliable estimates than a representative sample. The SFCC and the SCF each has an explicit high-income supplement. The MESP dataset has an implicit high-income supplement since it is based in large part on income data from the IRS tax file, which is not top-coded like the current population survey and most other publicly available survey data. Moreover, the accounting framework, the choice of observational unit, and patterns of response error because of portfolio variation with wealth class also affect wealth estimates. Median wealth plummets over the Great Recession. Table 2.1 in the bonus PDF documents a robust growth in wealth from 1983 to 2007, even back to 1962. Also refer to Figure 2.1 in the bonus PDF. Median wealth increased at an annual rate of 1.63% from 1962 to 1983. Then slower at 1.13% from 1983 to 1989, then a little faster at 1.22% from 1989 to 2001, and then much faster at 2.91% from 2001 to 2007. Between 2007 and 2010, median wealth plunged by a staggering 44%. Indeed, median wealth was actually lower in 2010 than in 1969 in real terms. The primary reasons, as we shall see in Chapter 3, were the collapse in the housing market and the high leverage of middle-class families. There was virtually no change from 2010 to 2013. As shown in the third row of Panel A, the percentage of households with zero or negative net worth, after falling from 18.2% in 1962 to 15.5% in 1983, increased to 17.9% in 1989 and 18.6% in 2007, Also refer to figure 1.2 in the bonus PDF. This was followed by a sharp rise to 21.8% in 2010, at which level it remained in 2013. Similar time trends are in evidence for the share of households with net worth less than $5,000 and less than $10,000, both in 1995 dollars, though in both cases there was a slight increase from 2010 to 2013. Mean net worth also grew vigorously from 1962 to 1983, at an annual rate of 1.82%, a little higher than that of median wealth. Its growth accelerated to 2.27% per year over years 1983 to 1989, about double the growth rate of median wealth. Over years 1989 to 2001, the growth rate of mean wealth was 3.02% per year, even higher than in the preceding periods. Its annual growth rate then reached 3.1% between years 2001 and 2007, largely due to the rapid 19% increase in housing prices. Mean wealth in 2007 was almost double its value in 1983, and about three-quarters larger than in 1989. Another point of note is that mean wealth grew about twice as fast as the median between 1983 and 2007. Indicating widening inequality of wealth over these years. The Great Recession also saw an absolute decline in mean household wealth. Although median wealth plunged by 44% between 2007 and 2010, mean wealth fell by only 16%. The main cause was falling housing and stock prices. Here, too, the faster growth rate in mean wealth than in median wealth, that is, the latter's more moderate decline, was coincident with rising wealth inequality. There was, again, virtually no change in mean wealth from 2010 to 2013, according to the SCF. However, aggregate data from the Financial Accounts of the United States, FFA, indicated a 27% jump in mean net worth over these years. As I shall argue in the next section, there is reason to believe that the SCF data understate average wealth gains over these years, and that the aggregate data may be more reliable for these years, at least for mean net worth. Median financial resources, FR, after expanding at a relatively slow pace of 0.55% per year from 1962 to 1983, grew 2.76% per year from 1983 to 1989 and 3.57% per year from 1989 to 2001, in both cases, faster than median net worth. Also refer to figure 2.3 in the bonus PDF. From 2001 to 2007, median FR fell at an annual rate of 2.41%, mainly due to a sluggish stock market and rising non-mortgage debt. All in all, median FR increased by 57% from 1983 to 2007, about 10 percentage points more than median net worth. When the financial crisis hit, median FR nosedived by 49% from 2007 to 2010, even more than median net worth, to only $13,500, its lowest level over the 50-year period. The main reason was across-the-board reductions in asset prices, as well as rising relative indebtedness. This was followed by a slight gain of 2.7% between 2010 and 2013. After holding relatively steady between 1962 and 1983, the fraction of households with zero or negative financial resources expanded from 25.7% in 1983 to 27.4% in 2007. Thus, the sharp decline in median FR from 2001 to 2007 reflected, in part, the growing non-mortgage debt of the bottom half of the distribution. As asset prices declined in 2010, the share was up again to 29.4%. There was a modest reduction in the share from 2010 to 2013 to 28.7%. Mean FR, after expanding at an annual pace of 1.38% from 1962 to 1983, grew at 2.7% per year from 1983 to 1989, and then at 3.44% from 1989 to 2001, in both cases faster than the gains in net worth. The pace then slowed down in the 2001 to 2007 period to 2.29%. Over the entire 1983 to 2007 period, mean FR increased by 104%, slightly more than mean net worth. Increases were almost identical for median and mean FR from 1983 to 2001, but because of the sharp falloff in median FR from 2001 to 2007, mean FR grew at about double the pace of median FR from 1983 to 2007. The bull market in stocks was largely responsible for the sharp growth in financial resources between 1989 and 2001, while the slow rise in stock prices, coupled with rising indebtedness, caused the slow growth in average FR from 2001 to 2007. Once again, there was a sharp falloff of 12% in mean FR from 2007 to 2010. But this percentage decline was substantially smaller than that of median FR and less than that of mean net worth. The difference was due to the fact that average net home equity fell by an enormous 28%. From 2010 to 2013, there was a slight gain of 2.4% in mean FR. Median household income, based on current population survey data, advanced at a fairly solid pace from 1962 to 1983 at 0.61% per year. Also refer to figure 2.4 in the bonus PDF. After gaining 2.03% per annum between 1983 and 1989, its annual growth dipped to only 0.48% from 1989 to 2001 and to 0.26% from 2001 to 2007, for a net change of 22% overall from 1983 to 2007. It fell off in absolute terms by 6.7% from 2007 to 2010. Though this is not an insignificant amount, the reduction was not nearly as great as that in median wealth or median FR. From 2010 to 2013, median income slipped by another 1.3%. Mean income, after advancing at an annual rate of 0.93% from 1962 to 1983, gained 2.66% per year from 1983 to 1989, gained 1.21% per year from 1989 to 2001, and then lost 0.14% per year from 2001 to 2007, for a total change of 35% from 1983 to 2007. Between 1983 and 2007, mean income grew less than mean net worth and FR, and median income grew at a much slower pace than median wealth. Mean income also dropped in real terms from 2007 to 2010 by 5.2%, slightly less than that of median income, but gained 0.9% from 2010 to 2013. In sum, while household income virtually stagnated for the entire American household from 1989 to 2007, median net worth, and especially median financial resources, grew strongly. Between 2001 and 2007, in particular, mean and median income changed very little, while mean and median net worth advanced robustly, as did FR, though median FR declined. The Great Recession, on the other hand, saw a massive destruction of median net worth and median FR, but much more modest declines in mean wealth, mean FR, and both median and mean income. Wealth inequality jumps over the Great Recession. Net worth is highly concentrated, with the richest 1%, as ranked by wealth, owning 37% of total household wealth in 2013, and the top 20% owning 89%. Refer to Table 2.2 and Figure 2.5 in the bonus PDF. The figures in Table 2.2 in the bonus PDF also show that wealth inequality, after rising from 1962 to 1969, returned to its 1962 level in 1983. Also refer to Figure 2.6 in the bonus PDF. After increasing again from 1983 to 1989, wealth inequality remained virtually unchanged from 1989 to 2007, at least according to the Gini coefficient. The share of wealth held by the top 1% rose by 1.4 percentage points from 1983 to 1989, and the Gini coefficient increased from 0.799 to 0.828. What was behind the uptick in wealth inequality? As chapters 3 and 5 will explore, two principal factors accounting for changes in wealth concentration are the change in income inequality and the trend in the ratio of stock prices to housing prices. First, there was a huge increase in income inequality between 1983 and 1989, with the Gini coefficient rising by 0.041 points. Second, stock prices increased much faster than housing prices. The stock market boomed, and the S&P 500 index was up by 62%, whereas median home prices increased by a mere 2%. As a result, the ratio between the two climbed by 58%. Between 1989 and 2007, the share of the top percentile actually declined a bit, from 35.2% to 34.6%, though this was more than compensated for by an increase in the share of the next four percentiles. As a result, the share of the top 5% increased from 58% in 1989 to 61.8% in 2007, and the share of the top quintile rose from 83% to 85%. The share of the fourth and middle quintiles each declined by about one percentage point from 1989 to 2007, while that of the bottom 20% increased by 0.2 percentage points. Overall, the Gini coefficient saw a very small rise, from 0.828 in 1989 to 0.834 in 2007. The years 2007 to 2010 saw a sharp elevation in wealth inequality, with the Gini coefficient rising from 0.834 to 0.866. Interestingly, the share of the top percentile showed a smaller relative gain, less than 1%. Most of the rise in wealth share took place in the remainder of the top quintile, and overall, the share of wealth held by the top quintile climbed by 3.6 percentage points. The shares of the other quintiles correspondingly dropped, with the share of the second quintile falling by 0.4 and that of the bottom quintile by 0.7 percentage points. From 2010 to 2013, there was a small rise in the Gini coefficient, from 0.866 to 0.871. The share of the top 1% did increase by 1.6 percentage points, but there was virtually no change in the share of the top quintile. In constant dollar terms, the net worth of the top 1% grew by 5.9% over those years, but that of the next 19% was down 1.8%. The wealth of the fourth quintile also lost 1.7%, that of the middle quintile fell 0.7%, and that of the bottom 40% declined 5.7%. FR was even more concentrated than net worth, with the richest 1%, as ranked by FR, owning 43% of total FR in 2013, compared to 37% for net worth, and the top 20 owning 95% compared to 89% for net worth. Refer to Table 2.2 and Figure 2.5 in the bonus PDF. The inequality of FR showed a different trend than net worth, mainly because of differences in timing between the housing market and the stock market cycles. Also refer to Figure 2.7 in the bonus PDF. The share of the top percentile climbed from 39.5% in 1962 to 42.9% in 1983, and the Gini coefficient showed a marked increase from 0.838 to 0.893, while the inequality of net worth was about the same in the 2 years. The share of the top 1% then gained by 1.2 percentage points, and the Gini coefficient increased from 0.893 to 0.920 between 1983 and 1989, trends, in this case, that mirrored those of net worth. Over the next 12 years, from 1989 to 2001, the share of the richest 1% plummeted by 4.4 percentage points, The share of the top 5% fell by 2.0 percentage points, and that of the top quintile by 1.6 percentage points. The share of the fourth quintile increased by 0.4 percentage points. The share of the middle quintile was also up by 0.4 percentage points. That of the second held its own, and that of the bottom quintile rose. As a result, the Gini coefficient fell from 0.920 in 1989 to 0.888 in 2001, and was actually slightly lower in 2001 than in 1983. The trend reversed between 2001 and 2007, with the share of the top percentile rising by 3 percentage points, that of the top quintile up by 1.7 percentage points, and the shares of the third and fourth quintiles and the bottom 40% all falling. As a result, the Gini coefficient rose from 0.888 in 2001 to 0.908 in 2007, still higher than in 1983, but lower than its previous peak value of 1989. The run-up in inequality from 2001 to 2007 was a reflection of the increase in the share of households with zero or negative financial resources. From 2007 to 2010, the share of total FR held by the top 1% actually declined.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.